Well, first of all, I must compliment you again. Your story was breathtaking and your achievements are quite remarkable. So thank you very much for this wonderful story that you shared with us. I would also want you to go to Texas, because in Texas they have maybe exact the same problems as you experienced, and they need you there to help them. Let me explain to you that in the United States, I will read a little bit from my book. It's called Death Row Dollies. It's a book about European women who start relationships with death row inmates in Texas, in the United States. And through the stories of these women, I dived into the world of death row. I dived into the world of people that defend death row inmates. I dived in the world of the anti-death penalty movement in Texas. And so I learned a lot about the death penalty in the United States. I will read you a little bit from this book about the defense. And your story, Susan, rang a lot of bells. In the United States of America, not the worst murderers get the death penalties, but those with the worst lawyers. Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who we all know, who before she died a couple of years ago, was a judge in the US Supreme Court, always said that it is very simple in America. People with good lawyers do not get the death penalty. She said that in the dozens of cases that are seen by the Supreme Court, I still have to come across the first of an offender who was properly defended. If you are poor, the court will appoint you a lawyer, just like in Uganda. These court-appointed lawyers earn an average of less than $1 per hour, and they get very small budgets to prepare a case and investigate. Prosecutors, however, get all the money they need for expensive investigators and experts. Because court-appointed lawyers rarely can win, their motivation is often hard to find, and there are, with few exceptions, no high flyers in the trade. Amnesty International documented numerous cases wherein lazy, unprepared, and unwilling defense counselors totally neglected their responsibilities to their clients and presented very little or no evidence or just one witness. Take the case against George McFarland, for example. He was condemned for the robbery and murder of a shop owner in small town Texas. His lawyer sat snoring loudly, snurken, in the courtroom. The lawyer was court appointed because McFarland could not afford a private lawyer. The lawyer's head would fall backwards, his mouth wide open, and continuously he would startle wide awake, hoist himself up and doze off again and again and again. In an explanation, the lawyer said later, "I am 72 years old. I always nap in the afternoons." McFarland appealed on basis of inadequate defense, but the appeals judge concluded that the Constitution of America says that one has a right to a lawyer, but it does not mention that a lawyer should be awake. During the court case against Calvin Burdine, his lawyer was also sleeping peacefully, chin on his chest, and therefore he said nothing when the prosecutor pleaded for the death penalty and not life imprisonment, because Burdine was gay. "For homosexuals, prison is no punishment," the prosecutor said, "but rather a party, a picnic." For 18 years, Burdine fought to have his case reviewed. Finally, he was allowed a new trial that resulted in a life sentence. In the 18 years, he was dragged 6 times from death row to the execution chamber to receive his lethal injection. Each time he was granted a last-minute stay. The prosecutor in his case reminded the court that in America, courts had all seen it before. Lawyers who were drunk, who were stoned, or confused, or unprepared, and lawyers with Alzheimer's. But never had it been caused to change a sentence, so why would it be any different with a sleeping lawyer? No one objected to the lawyer who called his client a stupid nigger son of a bitch, except for the client himself who wanted a new lawyer. The judge, however, rejected the demand and the jury sentenced him to death. And it's anyone's guess what the strategy was of the lawyer who said in his plea to the jury that you've seen with your own eyes what a pathetic, empty, purposeless, blubbering creature my client is. The blubbering creature was sentenced to death. There have been lawyers who never asked to see the files of their clients and who missed the deadlines for appeals or file appeals with the wrong court. In all these instances, it resulted in a death sentence. And there are also the mentally ill who are sent to death row. They cannot afford a proper medical test. Somewhere in the deepest depth of death row's dungeons, a man has survived since 1976. He is still alive today. His name is Raymond Riles. He's been there for 45 years on death row, longer than anyone else in America. When I asked to see him, the warden had never heard his name before. Nobody ever asked about Raymond, not family, no friends, no journalist. Raymond had killed a second-hand car dealer after they had an argument about a car in 1974. Three times he got an execution date. Each time he received a last-minute stay because the Supreme Court found him mentally ill and therefore unfit for execution. Raymond has got mad after 45 years on death row. I asked him, and he does not comprehend where he is or why he deserves to be executed. But they keep him on death row anyway because he may recover and then he can be executed. Death rows in the United States are full of mentally ill people. Experts believe that just about 100% of them, of all death row inmates in the US, suffer from trauma due to maltreatment and sexual violence from when they were children. I have seen the miserable details in many files of death row inmates. Bobby Moore, for example, his mother had the habit of hoisting her son up by chains on his ankles and then horsewhipping him. Stephen Staley's mother tried hammering a wooden stake through his heart. The mother of Michael Toney bought boyfriends home. One such lover tied Michael to a chair and set his hands on fire. It did not make a difference in court. He got the death penalty. They were raped by their fathers, grandfathers, brothers, and neighbors, hit on the head with an iron or a hammer, set on fire, roasted on hot stoves, and they were starved. You can't make up what grown-ups have actually done to most of them when they were still children. The Supreme Court in 2012 ruled that the mentally ill cannot be executed, but most states execute them anyway because it is left up to the states themselves to decide what mentally ill means. Ricky Rector was brain damaged. He first committed his murder and then he shot himself through the head. He was executed. For his last meal, he asked for a steak and a slice of pecan pie. He did not eat the pie because he wanted to save it for later. We often hear that the death penalty in the United States is riddled with racism. It is true that there are more black people than whites on death rows, but I believe it is much more a matter of poverty and inequality. There is not one millionaire to be found on death row. Thank you.